What's up, Warriors? Guy Beverage with Protector's Toolkit, Christian safety and security made simple. I've got a special treat for you. Last night, my brother, Jason Hensley from Shadow Mountain Church out in California, and I had an opportunity to sit down and interview John Maynard. Now, that name may not mean anything to you just yet, but John Maynard did a video that he put out on his Facebook page, and it quickly blew up. It went viral all over the world. John has gotten comment after comment on his video on how it impacted people all over the world, had people dedicating their life to Christ, had people rededicating their life to Christ. And isn't that part of the Great Commission? This is a Proverbs 27:17 message like no other. So sit back and relax and watch the video that John produced. And then after that, watch the interview that I had and Jason had with John Maynard. Thanks so much and keep him safe.
Have you ever had somebody send you something that was just too good not to share, but maybe a little too much to type? Well, my dad sent me something the other day and I thought it was awesome. So I was just going to share it with you. If you take this basketball right here, you put it in my hands, yeah, it's worth about $15. That's it. But you put that basketball in the hands of LeBron James, it's worth about $30 or $40 million. You take this football right here, you put it in my hands, it's worth about, I don't know, $10, $11 probably. You put it in the hands of Peyton Manning, it's worth about $50, $60 million. Depends on whose hands it is. You take this golf club right here, you put it in my hands, it might be worth $50, maybe. You put it in the hands of Tiger Woods, though, it's worth $80 million. You see, it depends on whose hands it in. If I have a stick in my hand, a rod in my hand, I might could beat away an animal or a wild animal or something trying to come at me. But you put it in the hands of Moses and it parted the Red Sea. You put a slingshot in my hands, it just becomes a kid's toy. You put it in the hands of King David, and he slays the giant with it. See, it depends on whose hand it is in. And, you know, two fishes and five loaves of bread would feed me with some bread left over. You put it in the hands of Jesus, and it feeds thousands. Depends on whose hands that it's in. If I had a couple of nails in my hand right now, I might would build you a birdhouse, if you're lucky. Might nail down a piece of wood. But you put them same nails in Jesus' hands, and it leads to salvation and eternal life for folks who love him and folks who trust him. You see, it depends on whose hands that it's in. And your worries and your cares and the things that's got you stressed out, if you leave them in your hands, that's all they're ever going to be. But if you put them same worries and cares and your problems in the hands of Christ, he's going to see you through it. He's going to take care of every need that we got. Y'all take care and have a blessed day. But just remember, it depends on whose hands that it's in. Give everything you got to God and let him handle it for you.
And for setting all this up, for sure. And Jason, you know how I roll, brother. I know you roll the same way. And John, I bet you're the same way. Why don't you, if you would, kick us off with a prayer there, Jason.
Got it. Dear Lord, we love you and praise you. And we thank you for the opportunity that, as Guy said, three brothers can get together and just have a conversation tonight. I just pray that everything that we talk about be to your honor and glory, that you're magnified, and that you're pleased with our conversation. In your son's precious name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let me move this around here so I can see this. All right, so if we could, John, I saw the video, man. I loved it. I loved everything about it. I shared it to, I can't tell you how many people I shared it to, and I couldn't get it in enough people's hands. And what a just a powerful message at the right time, for sure. And I think it impacted a lot of people. I mean, obviously, all over the world in the same way. So what I'd like to do is kind of hear about John. I mean, you're this internet sensation now, when you, on this huge rise. So I kind of want to know who John is a little bit. I think people that are with us at Protector's Toolkit, they probably want to know a little bit about you as well, if you don't mind sharing.
Oh, no, not at all. I mean, I'm a simple guy, man. I mean, most people can tell that by the way I talk when they first started watching the video. Some people are like, I can't understand this guy, you know, but, you know, I'm just a simple country guy, you know. I did 16 years in law enforcement and here in the state of Georgia. And, you know, I finally hung that up about 2.5 months ago, and I'm married, and we have four children together, three girls and a little boy. So, I mean, I'm just blessed beyond measure at this point right now. And but that's the I'm a simple dude. I don't have a big story to tell you right now, you know.
Yeah, very good, very good. Man, 16 years in law enforcement, you know, when we were chatting earlier today, you kind of shrugged it off that you didn't retire. But, man, hey, 16 years, that's a good long lick in law enforcement. So my hat's off to you for that. It's no easy task, and it's not getting easier by any stretch of the imagination either.
That was one of the things – I'm sorry about that. I didn't mean to interrupt you. That was one of the things that finally got me in it, you know, is – my heart started changing. I surrendered my call into the ministry back in 2007. So I've been actually preaching before the churches for, you know, several years. But over the years, I never wanted to be a pastor. All I wanted to do was just tell people about Jesus and how much he loves them. That's it. But over the years, my heart began to change some. And I really got tired of seeing people hurting. Every time you go on a call with law enforcement, very, very rare is it ever anything good. And I just got tired of dealing with people's pain every single day, day in and day out from, you know, just sometimes bad decisions. But, you know, it took a toll on me. It was just time to walk away. And now I see why.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very similar story.
Are you a pastor now?
Funny you ask that. About 8 hours ago, my best friend and I, we put up a video that we're actually going to be planning a church right here in our area called Resurrection Church. We're going to co-pastor this thing, and we're stepping out on faith. We've been fighting it for a year, and man, it was just time to let go. About 3 weeks ago is when we finally made the decision. We talked with our current pastor and gained his blessings, and we're ready to see what God's going to do with us.
That's awesome.
Fantastic, brother. Wow, what good news. I hopefully this is an exclusive, and we're going to let people know, man. And how fantastic is that, man? That's just amazing. You know, it used to, as a new Christian, it used to, back in the day, it used to amaze me the things that God would do. Not so much anymore. You know, I kind of just, I get in the ride and I hold on and give it all to him. I'm pretty famous for saying, you know, I used to ask God to bless the things that I'm doing, but more often than not nowadays, I ask God what he will bless, and I'll just do those things. So it's a lot easier that way.
Oh yeah. It works out better that way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So your ministry started way before the week and a half ago when you produced this video.
Oh, 100%. You can go back through my stuff for years, and I've always been trying to share something inspirational to people, whatever it is that it can be so small, but whatever it is that God gives me, somebody somewhere needs to hear it. And that's all I want to do is just tell them.
Hey, so I have a quick follow-up to that, the video itself. You had mentioned at the beginning of the video that your dad had given you that analogy, and then you just shared the analogy your dad gave you, and then it just went crazy, right?
Yes.
Wow.
That's pretty much how it worked. I mean, we have a family group that we're in, about 20 of us from my family. And late one night, the 20th, I think it was, of this month, Dad said, I want to share something with you guys. And he sent some screenshots of something that he saw on Facebook. And I can't recall the lady's name, but I couldn't find her on Facebook when I tried to find her to find out where she got it from. And I never could find her. And it weighed on me for 2 days. And then I was like, I've got to do something with this.
Yeah.
And the rest is history, man. God just really just stepped in.
You know, I've had a similar experience in my life where my mother-in-law, I love my in-laws to death. They are, they're very close to my best friends. And she gave me an analogy a long time ago about, you know, a parade and your position in the parade and God's position in the parade. And it stuck with me, and it was very impactful at the time. And I've shared that in law enforcement. I've shared that. I couldn't even tell you the number of times I've shared that with people in a time when I think they need to hear it. You know how you just get that feeling like, hey, this person needs to hear that analogy right now.
Yes.
You know, it's the Holy Spirit working on you and whispering in your ear to do that. Wow, that's a powerful thing. And nowadays with the social media presence that we have, I am so honored not only that I got to hear the message, but I'm just so amazed at how many people have been impacted by that message, and I'm so thankful for God working in that way in you.
Absolutely, man. I'm the same way. I mean, it's like I told you, man, in the beginning, I am a simple, humble guy. I'm new to this. You know, several months back, I watched something from Bishop T.D. Jakes, and he said it best. He said, I didn't want to be famous. I wanted to be effective. And he said that being famous is the consequences of being effective. And that's kind of, that's it. That's all I want to do, is I want to effectively give people, even if you are across the world and I can't even speak your language, I want to effectively be able to present the gospel to you.
Yeah.
And you had Franklin Graham, right? Franklin Graham reposted it. You had Ben reposted. Ben, I mean, yeah. Good grief.
Yeah, I mean, who's that guy, right?
When I first got that screenshot, a friend of mine sent it to me from up in North Georgia. I used to go to church with him, and he said, hey, that video is going crazy. And I was like, yeah, dude, I mean, I don't know what God's doing. And he said, well, Franklin Graham just shared it. And I said, huh? I said, stop lying. And he was like, I'm not. And he sent me the screenshot. And I mean, you know, last I checked several hours ago, it was up to almost 6 million views.
Holy smokes.
The one that Jason...
I think it's more than that.
Yeah, well, the one that Jason shared when he got a hold of it was up to 3 million views now, or pretty close thereabout.
I was blown away.
I have no idea. I don't, you know, and I have a local pastor here who I love to death. His name is Brad McKenzie, and he called me one day, and I think it has been up now like 4 days or something. And he said, John, he said, if you just take your video alone, just the original that you posted, with 1.7 million views, he said, I went back and did the math for you. He said, five people every second begin watching this video since the time you posted it.
Holy smokes.
And now the truth of it was, what at that time, when you count Reverend Graham's and you count Jason's and then you count the Tyrese actually got a hold of it on Instagram. And then Pastor Graham also put it on Twitter. When you compiled all that, it was almost 7 million views at this time. And I said, well, Brad, I said, buddy, check this out. It's actually almost like 15 people every single second that begin to watch that video. And there, and Brad put it best. He's like, there is people that prepare their entire life to be able to reach a crowd like that. And God did that through you. Yeah. I can't grab that, guys. I just can't grab that, you know?
Yeah, that's I can only imagine that. Yeah, go ahead, Jason.
Absolutely.
It's a God thing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I mean, and you think about the message in itself, just the message. What is it, 2 minutes and a few seconds?
2 minutes and 18 seconds, yeah.
Yep. But just the message is just, John is so powerful. I mean, it's brass tacks. And the crazy part is, I mean, whether it was quarantine and all the stuff that's going on with the virus and everything that our society and country is going through right now, the message in itself is exactly what our country stands in need of right now at this moment.
Absolutely. I agree wholeheartedly. I mean, the book of Isaiah says that when he looked in there and he saw God seated on the throne, you know, nothing takes God by surprise. He wasn't up pacing, looking down from heaven, looking to the left, looking to the right. He was seated on his throne because he's not taken by surprise. All of this was a divine meeting for you to find this video and share it, for Franklin Graham to find it, for my dad to send that, and for heaven's sake, whoever originally was the author of this, I thank God for them, because of them, it made it to me somehow. And then God just said, you know, he chooses who he's going to use. And for some reason, he chose a little old country boy that can't get out of the rain, you know? So.
Yeah. It's absolutely amazing. You know, when all this first started happening, you know, it would have been really easy for us to just go boo-hoo-hoo, you know, we can't go to church, we really hate it. But quite frankly, in my life, and I bet you guys are the same way, I've really, at night when I'm praying with my kids and praying over them before they go to bed, I've said it countless times, I thank God for this pandemic, for the virus, because what it has done for Christianity is so, so remarkable. It's more than we could have done here on earth ourselves. You know, it's a godly thing. It's slowed everybody down. It's put families back together that maybe were split apart. It's made people connect to people. Look at your neighborhood groups out there. People are helping people. People are baking bread for people. People are giving people stuff that they don't need anymore and they need. And then look at the church where we finally realize, hey, you know, we if we were thinking about a digital platform, we've now been pushed into doing digital. And so we're impacting so many more people in our communities. If you look at the numbers of online church presence, those numbers are huge now. And so
ours is quadrupled.
Yeah. That is a God thing. This whole thing has been a God thing. And your message has been a God thing. And it is because God slowed everything down that people were able to listen, and it didn't fall into the background. It didn't fall into all the noise out there. And it wasn't from a celebrity.
Right.
You didn't do it from your yacht.
No, I did it from my, nobody's going to believe me. Nobody's going to believe me, but God knows my heart. Okay. You guys will probably believe me. I like you guys. But I did this. Seriously, I was about to leave my house and go to work. And then finally it hit me. And said, John, do the video that I've been telling you to do. Just do the video. So I grabbed my daughter's basketball. I grabbed my son's football. And I grabbed my golf club out the corner. I set it on the table out back. And I said, okay, here we go. I hit record. I did it one time. I turned it off. I went on about my way. I uploaded it as I was riding down the road. Of course, hands-free. And I let it upload on its own. And that was it. I never thought any more about it. I didn't record twice. I didn't proof it. I didn't do anything. And you want to absorb this moment and just sit back and say, wow, look what God has done.
Yeah.
At the same time, for me, I want to like crawl up under a rock and say, don't remember John Maynard. Don't ever remember John Maynard. You remember Jesus and what his hands did for us all those years ago and what he could do for you now if you allow him to. That's all I want you to know.
Yeah. I preach that when I teach, I travel the nation and do church safety and security courses. And that's one of the things I preach. You know, if we could stop worrying about what's on the sign out front, worrying about what's over the door, and then start focusing on who God was and who Jesus was, and we serve a living God, we'd be so much better as Christianity, as a group. And stop worrying about, you know, do we have music in church or do we not? Do we dance in church or do we not? Are we allowed to eat or not? You know, we start worrying about who God is and who Jesus was and is, we'll be a lot better as Christians. We'll have a louder voice.
That's right. That's exactly right. I mean, if churches everywhere would get out of the legalism sometimes.
Sure. Okay?
And I understand there has to be order in the church. That's biblical. I get that. But if we get out of the legalism sometimes, and if you would just, if pastors all across this country would teach their people how to fall in love and stay in love with Jesus Christ, everything else will fall into place.
Amen. Amen.
Preach.
So, John, let me ask you.
Started.
What?
We'll have an altar call for God.
Right.
When did you know, when did you get the inkling or the feeling that this thing was going so-called viral?
I mean, it was a no-doubter when I found Jason's. I found Jason's video, I had a friend of mine I used to work with in another law enforcement town here. He sent this to me, and he's like, awesome word, man, and this and that, and just, all, you know, and I looked down, and I said, wait, Jason? Who's Jason? And then I looked down and this thing had like a million views or something. I was like, okay, what's going on? At that point there, I was like, this thing is going crazy right now.
Okay.
This blew up.
Yes.
Yeah.
Listen, I can tell you guys, and you guys can look at the comments, especially on Reverend Graham and on Jason's video that they shared. You can read the comments and get a feel for what's going on. I've got about 400 messages in my inbox from people from Germany, Spain, Brazil, Canada, Alaska, all over the world. And these are real people that are messaging me, telling me how much that they appreciated the message and this and that. And the only thing I stopped back and say was like, God bless you. And God gets all the glory for this, not me. But the point of it is you can see the surface on what these people are willing to comment for the entire world to see.
Yeah.
But what you can't see is where God said, you know, put something in their spirit to where you can tell this guy it's okay. And then I had one lady that messaged me and I didn't even know I could do this, but God guided me to be able to do this. She said, I really enjoyed your video, but my mother is deaf, and she reads lips really well, but she couldn't pick up. And I know that's because I'm country, right? Sometimes I think I speak in cursive. But so I went to YouTube and found a way to turn on the captioning. And then I did a screen record of it to where it had the caption on it, and I sent that to her, and she sent it to her mama. Her mother messaged me today. It's on my Facebook page where she commented how much she appreciated her being deaf and finding a way for her to be able to see the captioning and be able to get the message. I mean, that's what it's all about. It's about getting the message to whoever. I got missionaries from Spain telling me how much they appreciated it, and they're going to translate that into Spanish and deliver the word. I don't care. Nothing that I post is copyrighted. I don't have a copyright on anything. Share away, remake it. I don't care. Just uplift Jesus. That's all I care about.
That's awesome, brother. Amen to that. You know, let's just talk about how God works in strange and mysterious ways. My mother is a sign language interpreter. So if there's more need for that, I bet you I could convince her to get down in the little corner of the box there while you're speaking and do sign language for people.
Listen, whatever the cost is, brother, I had a pastor in North Georgia, and he would say this almost every Sunday, and we even had it on our bulletins, reach the lost at all costs.
That's right.
And we have, right. Now here's the reality of it, and Reverend Graham, God rest his soul, Billy Graham, believed that 80% of the church was lost.
Okay? Oh, yeah.
Now, listen, this is the problem. Reach the lost at all costs. We have no idea how many people inside of our churches every week are actually lost. No offense to church camps or no offense to anything like that, but we get into a rut of thinking that because I said this prayer, I'm saved. I'm good to go. And unfortunately, there are some people that go through their entire life and realize, luckily, there are some people that realize on this side of heaven that they truly didn't have it. And I just think if we could find a way to harness and say, you know, you've really got to get it. It's more than just a, you know, quote unquote, Mickey Mouse prayer. Let's get this thing, you know? And I don't know, man.
Yeah. You know, and Jason, jump in whenever you want. I hate to monopolize things, but just so many things are going on that, you know, one of the things I've said to people, you know, when I'm trying to encourage them to come to my church is I can remember going to church as a young man. I'm very fond of saying I was a Presbyterian Catholic. There's not a lot of those. My mom was Presbyterian. My dad was Catholic.
Right.
So, you know, we went to the major holidays. We went to the Catholic church, and all the rest of the time we went to the Presbyterian church. And mostly I was drugged there by my grandmother. So
it explains everything now.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Hey, I like juice and sandwiches cut into triangles. So if that's your experience with church, and then you grow into a young person and a young man, then you don't want to do that anymore, right?
That's right.
So when I'm telling people, hey, come to my church, I've got to make sure they understand, hey, this is not your grandmother's church. This is not, we're going to drag you by the ear church. This is, we're going to show you who Jesus is by how we act and what we do. And we're going to preach biblical truths about him. And so, you know, we've got to convince people. And I think a video like this connects the way it connects because of that. It impacts people in a way they can understand. They can put it in perspective, the basketball, the football, the golf club, and they can put that in a perspective for them. And it lets them just kind of open that crack just a little bit to say, okay, let me know more about this, right?
Hey, while you're on that too, one of the guys on my team wanted me to ask John, how in the world can you build a birdhouse with two nails? I'm just saying.
It's a very small birdhouse, okay?
Got it.
Hey, when you have Franklin Graham on your
blue,
side,
right?
He's got Franklin Graham on his side. I'm sure Dr. David Jeremiah has seen it by now. So listen, man.
I sent it to the
What
boss.
Happened with the loaves and the fishes, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, you put it in the right hands, it's gonna happen.
That's right.
Well, apparently he had five loaves and two fishes tonight for dinner.
Yeah, right.
So, I actually had three.
Well, I mean, you're a growing boy. I expect nothing less.
That's right. Still growing.
Well, very good. So, John, let me share a little bit about Protector's Toolkit with you because I'm going to put this on our membership site. And I'm going to put it on our Facebook page and all our social media too. So Protector's Toolkit, I used to work for a company called Strategos International. I traveled all over the nation teaching and setting up church safety and security. Small church, medium church, large church, didn't matter. Jason and I have talked before. I've helped Pastor Hagee's church before. It really, really enjoyed that and loved the company to death. But towards the end of last year, you know, I was in the business development side and traveling quite a bit. And things were just weren't gelling for me. And I really felt there was a gap that existed in what we were doing, because we would do live in-person trainings on site with a church, and we would invite all the churches from the surrounding area to come to this one location. And maybe a church could send one, maybe two people based on the cost and what their budget was. So you're only impacting maybe one or two people from each church that attended, maybe three or four from the host church that was hosting the event. And then what I did on Friday and Saturday is I fired them up not only for God and Jesus, but also for safety and security and protecting the flock. We went over everything from basic church safety and security to advanced stuff. And then I leave on Sunday. I'm gone. And there's really, then that gap exists on how they translate it to their team, if they can remember what all the stuff is. And then most of the team members and the leadership are volunteers. So when Monday hits and your 9-to-5 job comes around, church safety and security goes back over here till Sunday, and then you pick it back up again. So it's very, very difficult after you attend something and you're on fire for it to keep going with it. So the gap that existed was how do I fill that Monday through Friday for these guys and Saturday and keep that training going and keep them engaged with their teams? And so I started the business Protector's Toolkit, and it happened, quite frankly, when I was doing the Daniel fast at the beginning of the year. Our church does the Daniel fast at the beginning of the year. We did the month of January. And right about the midpoint, you know, when I'm praying and getting more connected to God and more connected to who he is in me and who I am for him, it really impacted me, because I've been having this struggle inside myself. Hey, just do it. You need to really do it, because these protectors, these warriors out there, they're on the wall just like Nehemiah. They need something. They need to be fed so they can protect the flock. We don't want to see another white settlement church shooting. We don't want to see another church shooting ever again. And so it really just impacted me in that way. And kind of like you, I can't shut it off when the big man's talking to me. So I picked up the computer, did my business license, and then the rest is history from there. So I really, really hope that the takeaway for the people on Protector's Toolkit is, you know, the messaging that, you know, we never know when we're going to be used, and we just have to be a conduit. We have to be open to it. And just like John, just to be ready for God to take you at any moment. And that, you know, that's one of the things I pray over my kids and over the family all the time is, God, please use me however you want to use me. I'm open to it. I'm open in any way you want to use me. And please give me the ears to know that it's you telling me to do it. And so that's where I think a lot of our protectors in the Protector's Toolkit or the protector world for church safety and security, I think that's where they are. They're wanting that opening with God, that connectedness, that feeling in their spirit, because it does get boring, you know. We're told the savage wolves are coming. We're told the roaring lions are out there looking to devour us. We're told to keep watch over ourselves and all the flock in Acts 20:28. But that when it doesn't happen, complacency sets in, and complacency is a really easy trap to fall into. And so, you know, this a video like this helps them connect more. And you know, the way you deliver it, you know, speaking in cursive with your accent, that connects with everybody that is doing this job. You represent the community that I serve. And so I'm really, really thankful to have you on here tonight so we can talk about that and get more in depth with that, because I think this is going to impact those protectors, those warriors as well. So I really thank you. Hats off to you for joining us tonight on this. So that's just kind of a snapshot of Protector's Toolkit.
No, I think it's a great thing. Matter of fact, at the church that I just gracefully, you know, left for the calling, I was actually part of our security team. I mean, it's a necessity nowadays. Yeah. I mean, unfortunately it is, you know, I mean, you're called to protect the sheep, not just to feed them. You're called to protect them. And this is part of it. So, that's off to you for listening to the call and taking care of thousands of sheep all over the place, even if they aren't directly yours.
Hey, you know what? You know, I'm coming to your church, right? You know that, right?
I'm okay, Bubba. You can come. You can come. As long as you put your cursive ears on, you'll be fine.
Yeah, I might have to listen a little slower.
That's okay. I'll try to talk a little bit more plain, you know.
Well, Guy and I have actually been talking for, I don't know, a couple of years about hosting a church safety conference here in San Diego. And, man, I would absolutely love to, down the road, figure a way of bringing you in as a keynote and just allowing you to speak the truth.
I'd be honored.
Cheap dogs.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I'd be honored. I'm still a big supporter of law enforcement. I always will be. It's in my blood. My dad was a MP, and he served some as well in the municipal world back in the early 80s, late 70s. So I'm a big supporter, always will be. I just know that that's not my job anymore.
Amen. So you and I are parallel. I got out about 3.5 years ago, and full-time ministry, and I love it.
Yeah, guy will be around for too long, you know. So,
I told my wife, if I get 3 bad days in a row, I'm out of this thing.
Oh, Lord. I don't know how you're not going then. That's all I can say.
Well, so I'm the constable here in Texas, and that's kind of a unique position. It's elected, and I run my own department. So not only everything that the law enforcement world does, we get involved with traffic investigations, all that, but we also manage the safety and security for all the justice courts, and we do all the civil process for our jurisdiction too. So, you know, the people keep electing me, and I keep impacting the community in a positive way. And I tell you, one of the most fun things I get to do is with my church, they gave me little 4x4 cards, and it gives the address and times of service. And anybody I impact that's having a bad day, they get one of those. And I say, hey, at 11 o'clock for this service, I will meet you at the front door if you want to be there.
That's right.
And so my life has kind of changed a little bit in that regard too, because, you know, when I started out in law enforcement, I was, you know, I either wanted to run you down or fight you, and that was it, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know if I could still do those things anymore, so I have to be a lot nicer to people.
You're getting old.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
I can handle the fighting part, but the running, nah. Nah, I'm not running.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
It's more than 10 steps, I'm out.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. Oh, yeah. That's right. The radio, you ain't going to beat the radio, I'll tell you that.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, I think as the world gets back on its axis and things are open back up again, Jason and I are definitely going to plan a conference to bring in the sheepdogs, the protectors, and you're definitely a good fit for us, brother. I think the world of you just from the video, you know, it's one of the things we're called to do that I think sometimes we don't do enough, or we're not, as men anyhow, I don't think we're quick enough to do. And that's tell another man that we love that man. And gosh, I would hate it if God didn't love me. You know what I mean? And so, you know, I love you, brother. I love Jason. And I tell my guy friends all the time, hey man, I love you. I don't care if they say it back or not, you know what I mean? But I know that's what I feel for them because I know what Jesus feels for me, you know, what God feels for me.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. And I'll tell you something else that's bad for me too. 6'3", 300 pounds. Now I'm growing a beard, and this guy loves to hug people. You know, could you see I just want to hug somebody. People think you're going to eat them sometimes. They're just like, oh, back away. But, you know. I'm like a teddy bear, you know. I love to hug people, and I love to tell people I love them. I don't care if you're guy, man, woman. I don't care. I love y'all.
That's right. That's right. That's right. So, any closing thoughts on your side, Jason?
No, it's John, man. It's been a blessing. What a crazy ride, and I mean, it's got to be for you. It was driving me and my wife crazy. My phone was just blinking the whole time. And I normally don't turn my stuff on public. And I thought, well, I'll throw this one on. And the crazy part was. Guy's actually the one who sent me your video.
Okay.
That was the cool part of this. He sent it to me, and I was like, oh, I'm going to share this thing. And it just kind of took off. And so, and like I did my post yesterday, these things just don't happen by accident.
That's right.
Yeah.
That God puts you there to do that. He used my social media to share part of it, share part of the story. And now it's brought 3 brothers in Christ closer together, all sheepdogs, 2 of us former sheepdogs are,
that's right,
law enforcement.
Yeah.
What a blessing, honestly.
Oh gosh, and, yeah.
And if only one person accepted Christ, it was worth it. I tend to believe that there were probably thousands that this has influenced, and that's
I
That's the key.
I can tell you, Jason, that there was one. I know for a fact there was one. She was from Oregon, and she messaged me on the second day. And she said, because of you, I've turned it all over to God. And I even asked her to make sure. I said, so are you telling me that you have accepted Christ for the first time in your life? She said she did. So for me, it could have cut off, been deleted, throw my Facebook away. It was worth it.
Yep.
Yeah.
But God had a bigger plan. Now we're 11, 12 million deep in this thing.
And that's what I think that's the other interesting thing here is that there are those people who are anti-social media and stuff, but you used that 2 minutes and 18 seconds to fulfill the Great Commission.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's touched 10 million people now.
It's incredible.
Unbelievable.
Incredible. I can tell you what, my grandfather on my mother's side, he preached for 50 years and he passed away last year. And my grandfather on my dad's side passed away at 91 and he preached for 20 or 30 years. And the greatest thing I have from both of them, not going to mean much to anybody else, but I have a handkerchief from each one of them that they used while they were preaching. And to me, they're worth thousands. And I went to church 9 months before I was ever even born. So I've been born into this thing, you know? And yeah. I'm like you, Guy, from what you said earlier, you know, maybe things aren't quite like it was with my mama's church or your grandmama's church, but I just want you to come in here, be loved for what you're wearing today, be loved for who you are today, be loved for whatever your past is, and to know that the same grace that was extended to me when I was lost is extended to you today. That's
Amen.
It.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Immediately. Immediately. You don't have to do anything for it. It's right there.
Yep.
Immediately.
But you just have to surrender. You have to repent. You have to literally turn from what you were and go the opposite direction. Some reason we have made it so complicated over the years when it is absolutely the most simple thing that you'll ever do in your life.
Yeah. Yeah.
It'll be hard now. It'll be hard, but it's simple.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
But I'm honored, you guys. I really am. I really am.
Well, we definitely thank you. And I think I'm just going to say it. I think there's more from you. There's more in you. I can see another couple of videos or whatever you want to do with this. However we can help in any way come out of this. I mean, just a couple, three dudes and God is sitting around drinking coffee or whatever, you have, water for Jason, working all day.
Now, he's from Georgia. This isn't moonshine. It's
water. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. But I do want to leave you guys with one more thing.
Yes, please.
I do have some more videos that are rolling in the back of my mind that I'm going to try, okay?
Okay.
And what I say by is I'm going to try is I will never try to and probably won't accomplish being able to duplicate what happened with that last video. But I can promise you before God and whoever watches this in the future that I'll always duplicate my obedience. So it may not ever hit 1 million, 10 million, 1,000, 100,000, I don't care. But I'll always duplicate my obedience. That's going to be a fact.
Amen. Amen. Yep, you can't shut it off. You can't tell the Holy Spirit to be quiet, you know.
He don't listen. I can't send any voicemail.
There's a sermon right there.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, yeah. Guys,
John, it's been a pleasure, my friend.
Yeah, if you'll let me, I'll close us out in prayer.
Oh, yeah. I'll let you, brother. I always love prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, you know, I would ask God that you would bless and keep John and Jason. Watch over them. Watch over their families. Be with them. Walk with them every step of their life, God. Shine your face upon them and be gracious to them. Please lift up your countenance towards them and give them peace. I pray, God, that they would be like trees planted next to the living water. Their leaves would never wither, and they would bear fruit in every season. Lord, we know your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path, and we pray earnestly that you keep shining the light for us. We thank you that we can live in your light and walk in your truth. May the things that we've revealed here tonight and talked about here tonight be shared all over the world, that your good news come into every ear and dwell in our hearts and stir us to action. Yes. It's all this we pray in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.